It's easier to admit I'm a mess than to be a mess.
This is Joe Wong. Welcome to the Trap Set. I want to play something for you. You're hearing The Butcher's Daughter by Trigger Hippy, featuring my guest, Steve Gorman, on drums. Gorman is best known as the drummer of the Black Crows, a band he joined in 1987. His musical maturity belied his relative inexperience, and his natural sense of time, coupled with a knack for rhythmic arrangement, helped the Black Crows become one of the most popular bands of their generation. Steve has also worked with artists such as Warren Zevon, Stereophonics, Jack Cassidy, and Joe Firstman. Earlier this year, Steve released his book, Hard to Handle, chronicling his time with the Black Crows. He's the host of the radio show, Steve Gorman Rocks, and Trigger Hippy released a new album, Full Circle and Then Some, in October. And now my conversation with Steve Gorman.
There was a couple times in the book where, when I was writing it and when I read it, where I really did just get sad, you know, without a doubt. It was the same chapter both times. The chapter in 2000 when Sven flames out. That was the hardest one to write for, and it was the hardest one to read, you know, for whatever reason. Those both took it out of me. But otherwise, it's funny, I was talking to Sven. I was with him about a month ago, and I told him that, and then I think the reason it was so difficult to write, which was Sven and I never actually, like, talked about that. Like, when I went back to the band in 05 and he was back, we just picked up where we had left off and it was all good. And we've always had a good, great relationship. We love playing together. We have a very copacetic flow together as people. And by the time I might have thought, hey, can we talk about 2000? You know, it was 5 years ago.
Would have been awkward.
Well, it just didn't seem to matter. There was no reason to. And I never thought there was a reason. Now I realize, no, well, there was obviously, it would have settled something in my mind. I was so happy he was back and okay and doing so well. I didn't want to go back there. So that was the only surprise, really, or even like cathartic part of the book was that, like, that really, and that chapter ends, that's my whole life in Atlanta ended pumping gas right across from the guy that brought me there. And as that was happening, it just broke my heart, and it broke my heart to write it. You know, it was all, again, it was like, that was the only thing that was really difficult to go through again. I mean, I'd processed all the rest of it.
Yeah.
And I realized, oh shit, I'd never really examined any of this and how it made me feel.
Well, how did you process all of it originally? I mean, did you go to therapy or something?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. 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 I had been dealing with the second half of the band from 2006 forward. It was pretty clear, like, it's not possible to get as emotionally embroiled as I was in the 90s. I'm not going to let that happen. There's no reason for it to happen. I'm going to be the best drummer I can be in this band, and it's a good gig, and I'm appreciative of it. And when we have nights where it's good, I'm thrilled.
Right. But, in the book, you talk about transitioning from it feeling like a band to feeling like a gig.
It was a band, and then it was a group. It was never a band after 97. It was a group, and it was a really good group at times. But as far as what that means to me, a band where everybody's got all hands on deck and everyone's on the same page and we're all doing things together, that never happened again after 97. It happened. There were some times when we were all together, but not six guys together. It was three guys with some side guys. That's a very different thing.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, you could say that me and the brothers were, we were still the band, but that's only three people. It's not really a full band, you know, and as far as, you know, with the intent anyway. And so its genetic makeup was just we could never be that thing again. And that's, I do think there's a magical quality to bands. And there's a chemistry and there's an alchemy, and it's, you can't fake it, and you can be really great. You can be really good without it, but to be great and to be special, you got to have it.
I always say it's like the difference between being in a marriage or having a one night stand or mm-hmm. dating around, and both have their place.
Sure, absolutely.
But I think being in a band is much easier when you're all young. I mean, part of that bond happens when you're so young and you're going through these experiences for mm-hmm. the first time together.
Of course.
And then you tend to put, in my experience, putting too much emotional stakes in other people.
Oh, it's
just some guy that you met when you're 20.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and that's, it took me years to figure that out, you know? I mean, a lot of the stories in the book, in the first part of the book, are to me, that's the bell I'm ringing. I'm like, I'm crazy. You know, I'm like, you know, I'm not, I don't know how it reads. The way it was written is, I'm very open about, you know, for every addict, there's a codependent, you know,
yeah.
for every bit of that band, you know, part of what made the Black Crowes special from say 91 through 96 was how sick we all were. And everyone had their own illness to deal with, you know, and everybody had their own strengths and they had their own weaknesses and they all commingled and they all just make this stew that was always toxic, but at least the band there was this thing that was created that went beyond the sum of the parts for a while.
Well,
it's easy to say, well, it's all worth it.
Mm-hmm. You know? And I think that, you know, music mythology advances this idea that that's the cost.
Yeah.
Of being great is being fucked up,
yeah.
Which is not true, actually.
No, it's not true at all.
The things coincide often, but it doesn't mean that it's causal.
Just because you decide that that's necessary doesn't mean it actually is. But, you know, it's like, any belief system, as long as everyone believes, it's real.
Right.
That's all it takes is everybody to say, I actually believe in this. And then it's as real as anything. And the minute you question or waver, it can unravel or it can just get stronger and actually make more sense. In terms of a marriage, that's certainly the case. You know, okay, let's take the blinders off and let's be real.
Mm-hmm. Like,
and then in a band, it's a little bit, it's a multi-headed monster. And then, you know, I think that it's also any job you have, every job I ever had, I wanted it before I got it. And I was like, man, if I was working at this record store, think how cool that would be. And then you get behind the counter and a month later, you're like, I got to get out of this fucking place. You know, it's like, I worked at Wax and Facts in Atlanta, Georgia, and it was the hippest thing I could have possibly done. And within a few months, I was like, I'm just filing records. I'm just punching. I'm just working a cash register. But I was aware of the fact that other people came in and looked at me like I used to look at the guys there like, man, Steve's cool. He's got this job. It had a cachet to it, but it's just a job. And multiply that by a bajillion. You know, you got a band. It's all I ever wanted was to be in a band.
And then it's successful.
And then it's successful way too soon and way too much. But, you know, but we would never admit that. You know, no, we got it. We got it under control.
That's what we call the hedonic treadmill, Steve.
Yeah.
But
destiny.
You know what?
You start saying words like destiny, it's over. You're just the last guy to know it.
When I was reading your book, I was thinking, man, if these guys would have just had a much harder time for another 5-6 years before they took off, they probably would have.
Yeah.
They probably would still be a band.
Yeah, no question about it.
But let's go back. So the book really focuses on your time in the Black Crowes.
Sure.
But then at the end, you mentioned that your dad was a Marine and that mm-hmm. you had five older brothers.
Yeah, and two sisters. But the sisters, in terms of, they didn't give me anything but love. Like I had,
they weren't sarcastic and abusive like the brothers?
No, not at all. No, that was like safe haven.
Because I would imagine they would have to be pretty tough to grow up around all these boys.
There was a toughness and then also an acceptance, a shitty acceptance of, oh, well, you know, we're kind of over here on our own little islands. You know, this is a very testosterone-fueled existence.
Where did you grow up?
I was born in Muskegon, Michigan. My parents are both from Detroit. So it's a Michigan family. I'm the youngest of eight.
Catholic?
Quite.
Yeah.
Quite Catholic. So folks from Detroit grow up and they get married in Detroit, have their first three kids in Detroit, move to New Jersey for a couple years, have two kids there, then move back to Muskegon, Michigan, where the last three kids were born. So I was born in Muskegon. And then when I was like two, we moved to just south of Baltimore, Maryland. My dad got a job. My dad was working with Brunswick when I was born. He was like the plant manager of the Brunswick. They're making bowling balls and bowling pins. And then we moved to Maryland. He got a job at a, Brunswick acquired a boat company in Baltimore. And it was a chance for him to jump, as I understand it, from like plant manager, like top dog in the blue collar world. He could move up to be like a VP, like make a big leap to white collar. And he took that shot and moved us all to Severna Park, Maryland in 1968. So I guess I was three. And so we were there until I was 10. And then we moved to Hopkinsville, Kentucky, when he got back into the bowling world and went to Ebonite Bowling Balls, which is based in Hopkinsville. So Maryland, really, till I was 10. I have no memory of Michigan. So, you know, my life, the lights came on in Maryland. And then when I was 10, we moved to Hopkinsville, Kentucky. And then I was there in Kentucky until I moved to Atlanta when I was 21. So everything I did that mattered was in Kentucky. You know, like, adolescence, puberty, high school, all that shit was all in Hopkinsville, Kentucky.
What kind of music was on in the house?
Well, in Maryland, it was everything because my older brothers had, I had one brother that was, my brother Tom was a rock guy, prog rock, you know, Yes and Hendrix and all this. My brother Jim was obsessed with soul music. It was just Al Green and Earth, Wind & Fire, early Earth, Wind & Fire, and Spinners and Four Tops, Motown and Stax. It was all that. So everything else was in between those two worlds. So in my house, those things were on all the time. When I was a kid, like five, I guess I was 6 years old, and my oldest brother, Bob, had a basketball game at his community college. And I went and I... my ticket stub, they called it out to win a door prize, my numbered ticket. And I went down and they gave me an album, and it was the Bee Gees' 2 Years On, which had Lonely Days on it. That was the big hit. So that is my first record. And so I took it home, and that's it, man. Bee Gees are my band. I'm down. And I listened to that record 50 times a day for months. I mean, I was obsessively listening to that album. And after a little while, it was probably only a few weeks really, but that's a long time when you're five or six. My brother Tom came in and he goes, we had a pool table. We had a room called the pool room, pool table and stereo. That's, you know, down off the den. That's where the kids hung out.
Did you have a bowling lane in your house?
No, we did not. But our garage was full of bowling lockers. Okay. Every kid had their own locker for their baseball glove and cleats and stuff.
Ah, orderly.
Pretty strong. And then we had bowling alley furniture in the house. Like the we had chairs like you see at a bowling alley back in the day.
And like with ashtrays and everything?
A couple of, not with the ashtrays, but they were like that fiberglass single body. And we did have some coffee tables that were from bowling alleys, like that, you know, crazy. But my brother Tom came down and he said, I can't hear the fucking Bee Gees anymore. And he handed me Meet the Beatles, Help, and Rubber Soul. And said, here, just play these. Mm-hmm. And by that time, I'd already gotten Best of Bee Gees. So I had two Bee Gees albums going. And so he handed me three Beatles albums. And I put on Help first. I just love the skis. I was like, I just like the pictures. So I went with Help. And I knew who the Beatles were in theory, but I didn't know. And I put on side one. And when Ticket to Ride started, I full on like a scene from a bad movie on Lifetime Network, I just started air drumming, and I didn't even know why or what I was doing. But that pattern, I just was like a zombie for Ticket to Ride. And I just listened to it over and over and over. And that first day. And then within a few days, I had all three of those albums just hard drive into the DNA of my brain. And I really was like, then I was like, I'm going to be a drummer. That's it. I'm here to drum. This is the reason I am on this planet. And I did absolutely nothing about it for years, but I knew early on that's what I wanted to do.
Right, because in your book, you mentioned that you didn't even buy a drum set until you were in your 20s. Mm-hmm. So what did you do in the intervening time?
Well, in fourth grade, I joined the school band, and I got a snare drum and like a set of bells, like a glockenspiel type of thing.
In a case.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Looked like a briefcase. I literally went to the music teacher in fourth grade and was like, I want to play drums. He goes, yeah, this is how you start. And I'm like, no, I want to play the kit. And he looked at me like I was crazy. And he goes, you got a snare drum and you're going to learn rudiments. And then you're going to learn how to play Yellow Rose of Texas on those bells. And I was like, that ain't going to happen. And I gave it a go. But within a couple weeks, I just was out of the band. I just refused to do the bells.
I always say that's like trying to teach a toddler how to spell before they learn how to talk. It just doesn't make any sense. It's so counterintuitive.
It was entirely counterintuitive. Like I say, it's trying to get toddlers to share. No, take turns. Sharing doesn't happen. You just got to say it's your turn or yours. Anyway, so that was it. I moved to Kentucky a year later. So to answer your original question, when we moved from Maryland to Kentucky, the four oldest kids were already out of the house. So they stayed on the East Coast. So the four youngest kids, which is my sister Ann, and then my Dave and Doug, two brothers and me, the four of us go to Kentucky. And then the music in the house shrunk considerably. We had my records, which are basically just Beatles records. And then Dave had a little, he had some Stones and Doors, all like classic rock stuff. And that was it. And then we got to an area where the only radio was like top 40 radio. There was no rock radio that we could pick up in 1975. So I went into a tunnel for a few years with just my Beatles records. And I was totally content to just listen to that. It wasn't until like the first punk and then new wave stuff. Like I'd see something on Saturday Night Live and I was like, what the hell is that?
Like you know? When Devo played on Saturday Night Live.
Life changer, literally. Yeah. I mean, I stared at the TV going, whatever this is, I'm all in, you know? And I saw U2 on Tom Snyder, you know, and like by the time I was in ninth grade, and I would hear about the Sex Pistols, and there'd be a thing on like, you know, the CBS Evening News would have a 60-second, this thing in England, and you'd see these kids with safety pins in their cheek. And I was like, what? There was a lot of great rock in the mid-70s that I was totally missed out on. I was never listening to Zeppelin or this. I got Some Girls was the first Stones record I ever got in real time, you know, like. So I was aware of that stuff. But most of the big rock stuff at the time, I just was oblivious to. And then, but I dove right into, I went right from like the Beatles and Wings and George Harrison and John Lennon solo records. Oddly enough, not the Ringo albums. I had Photograph was my first 45. I mean, I had it, but then I went straight into, then I was really into Earth, Wind & Fire for a while. And at one point, Earth, Wind & Fire and Devo were my two bands at the same moment in time. Like I was obsessed with like All in All and Are We Not Men at the same time. But then straight to like, you know, like Blondie and, you know, the B-52s and Devo and U2's first album. By like 78, 79, 80, it was just all stuff you couldn't hear on the radio. And I was totally like the kid in my school that liked weird music. And I wore that like a badge of honor.
But you weren't really playing?
Never. No, not playing a thing.
But did you still think that you would become a drummer?
Yes. In my head, I was always going to be a drummer.
So why didn't you just like get a paper route and buy a drum kit with that money and do it?
That would have made way too much sense. You know, this is why, because I asked about drums like once and it was shot down immediately. You know, my dad was like, we're not getting a drum set in this house. I mean, just stop. Had I gotten a paper, I did have a paper route for one summer. If I had just decided this is worth doing. It's funny because I now know my dad probably would have been like begrudgingly respectful because I was just going to do it no matter what. I was just, at that point, I think I was already, my position in the family as the baby was sort of, I got along with everybody. And I was just like, I wasn't here to make waves. I saw my older siblings screwing stuff up and getting crushed by my parents. And I was like, I'm not doing that. You know, I was already just
You were already laying the groundwork for your codependency later on.
100%. But I met a few guys over, like in high school, there was a dude I knew had a drum kit and I went over to his house once. I said, can I try that? And he said, yeah. And I sat down and I immediately started playing it. Like I knew what to do.
It was intuitive to you.
I'd been watching and upset. All I did was watch. And, you know, if a band was on TV, I just watched the drummer. When I would listen to records, I always heard the songs first. It was never like, this drummer's amazing. I'm going to listen to this album all day. I had to like the songs. But then I would just think about the drum parts. And then I would literally think about what's the bass doing when he's playing that groove and why? And does that, and I would try to connect it all in my head. When I moved to Kentucky, I picked up a ton of OCD stuff, you know, which I mean, this all makes sense to me now. At the time, I thought that everybody counted every sentence in fours. So I thought everybody landed every flight of stairs on their left foot. You know, I had all these things I did. I would literally, everything I said, every sentence, I saw 1, 2, 3, 4, like a four. I saw a little box of, you know, four corners, and every syllable would always come around and end on the four. And I would add words to make sure that what I said to you ended on the four. Like, that shit was going all the time.
Can you still do that?
I can do it, and then I don't keep doing it.
Can you show me as an example?
Well, yeah. So, okay, like...
Like, so if I ask you...
If I'm talking to you, and I want to end on this, which is the... This is the four. If I want to end on the four, I would add, like, you know, just say something so that it made sense by the end of what I wanted to say right here now.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, just whatever. I was much more efficient when I did it all the time. But everything would end in fours. And I mean, I know enough about OCD to know what that implies, and to just my, you know, I'm moving just through the world out from under me. You know, the rug flew out from under me, changing, and I lost half my family. I mean, it was like devastating
so
it to
was
me
like,
as a kid.
So you would say it's a way of like trying to exert control?
Exactly, 100%.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Because I never did a bit of that in Maryland. I got to Kentucky, and within like a month, I got to Kentucky at 10, and the first thing I thought was, how am I getting out of here? And I held on to that for a while. And I had a few other things I did that were totally like that. Like, and then when I learned how to type in 11th grade, it almost killed me, because then I typed in my head everything I ever said. And I was I was the fastest typist in my school.
How fast could you type?
It was like 70 words a minute mm-hmm. on an actual typewriter, mm-hmm. you know, without mistakes in 11th grade. And they're like, man, you're really good.
You could be a secretary.
And in my mind, I'm typing. Yeah, it's because I'm kind of crazy. You know, I'm obsessed with never making a mistake with my, you know. So, you know, all that shit was all. But I was a totally normal guy. I was playing sports. I had a girlfriend. I had a ton of friends. I mean, I wasn't an angst-ridden kid. Like, plenty of people were having a much worse life than me at that time. It was all my internal shit.
So it wasn't debilitating per se.
No. I was good. I mean, as for a guy with all that shit going on, I was just fine. Like, I really enjoyed playing sports, and I did have great friends. I have friends that I'm still very close to. You know what I mean? It's like, it's all good. But I know people who have that shit to a debilitating level, and I don't mean to. I was nowhere near that. It was all manageable to me. Which is really all that matters. Like, are you managing it? Yes, I'm doing it, but it's not keeping me from, you know, whatever.
When did that start going away?
It all went away. It started going away when I started playing drums.
Because you could channel that energy into drumming?
I moved to Atlanta at 21. I had a recurring dream for years that once I moved to Atlanta, went away. And the short version of it is I could fly indoors.
That was your dream?
I could fly if I was inside. And every time I would land and run outside, and I couldn't fly outside. And it just, that happened for years. And the minute I moved to Atlanta, I never had that dream again. It was like, because I was in my head, I was doing all these things. And then once I actually started to do them, I wasn't boxed in. I didn't feel trapped. You know, like, I had this incredible sort of fantasy life for years. I always imagined being in a band, and I was going to be in a band. I was going to be the drummer. When I got to college, I started playing drums. I didn't own a kit. I just knew a couple different guys that I could borrow a kit, or I could just go to their house and just play. But I never had a lesson. I never had any sense of, I was just playing what I heard in my head.
Were you confident?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Always. And that was a lot of the jock in me. You know, I was a good basketball player. And I used to say, like, I might fuck up, but it ain't going to be because I'm scared. You know, like, I'm if anything, I'm going to push too hard, you know, but I would be nervous. And the first few gigs I played, I was terrified. But my reaction to being nervous about a show was to just go all in, you know? So from the jump, like, the first gig I ever played with a band, like an actual gig in a club with, when I first moved to Atlanta with Mary My Hope, I mean, I was petrified, but, you know, when it was over, all anyone said was, man, that was great. You know, people were like, dude, you're actually really good. And, you know, I wasn't, but I wasn't bad. That's the, you know, young drummer starting out, if you're not bad, you're pretty good. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I was always aware of, and I think that OCD stuff was really a big part of why I was good off the bat. I was aware that I wasn't confident about doing fills, but I was confident that I could just lay a groove down for, you know, how long do you want to go? Like, I'll just sit here and play. And I kind of saw it as like, just like, I'm just dribbling a ball. I'm just working on my ball handling, you know, it's like, it's not flashy, but you can't steal the ball from me. I mean, I'd put stuff into basketball terms all the time back then. Most drummers have that 5 or 6 years in the basement by themselves trying to be Keith Moon. And I never did, you know what I mean? And so that was actually really helpful, was joining a band, because I was just like, how's the song go? I'm just going to play the beat. I'm going to play underneath it, and I'll keep us pretty close to the same time we start. and you're never going to wonder where the one is.
It's interesting.
And that's pretty darn important in a young band.
Interesting because you talk about Rich in the same terms in the book, in that he never really learned how to play a bunch of other people's music when he was starting out on guitar.
Yeah.
So maybe that kind of combination, way that you two locked in with one another is what gave you part of the sound.
Oh, I think that's absolutely. It's a huge thing. You know, I think all three of us were on the same level of, there's a lot of talent here. We have no idea what to do with it. We haven't been taught. We refuse to learn. We're going to figure it out ourselves. We just had a common aesthetic and a mindset that made sense, way more than anything we sounded like in 1987. We just all had this, goes back to the, you know, the mythology and the belief and the, you know, my line back then was always, we're the worst band in Atlanta and the best band in the world, you know, and I really did believe that. You know, both those statements were absolutely true in my mind.
So what did you mean by that?
I meant, yeah, I know we suck, but fucking wait, because this is going to be great. You know, like I understood fully well what a small group of like-minded people can accomplish if they just don't worry about things like credit and just let's all go together. And I'd already seen things and I'd already had experiences, not in bands, but with in sports and in even things like school projects and anything that I had ever been a part of that worked. It was always because everybody went somewhere together. And that's what everyone, and you always felt good when it was over. Even if you didn't win, you literally had a thing of, hey, but that was a good experience. We all did something. And, you know, that's just how I thought the band should be. I didn't for a minute think that anybody wouldn't see things like that. That was just like, yeah, that's just how it is, right? And it was a long time before I finally went, I don't think everybody thinks like this. I think it's just me that thinks this is how this works.
I think other people probably think that way, but they just have a different interpretation of how it manifests.
Well, that's true. Yeah, thinking it sounds good.
Everybody might be thinking, okay, we're all in this together, and everybody's thinking the same way that I'm thinking. Mm-hmm. That's what you do when you're young, right? You project your own worldview onto the people that are closest to you.
I'm guilty of that as much as anybody, if not more. And my senior year in high school, my coach, we were like, at one point in our season, we were like 2-5, or, you know, and he said, we were talking and he goes, hey, you got to stop scoring. And I was like, I'm sorry, what? He goes, listen, every time you're our leading scorer, we lose. You get that, right? Like, because there's a couple guys in his team and that's really all they can do. He explained it in a way. He's like, we're better if you're focused more on getting rebounds and setting them up. And then you're going to get your points off offensive rebounds, blah, blah, blah. There's this whole thing. Basically what he was saying was, don't look for the spotlight. Just do all the other stuff, because some of the other guys can't do all those other things. It made perfect sense to me. I was like, oh, okay, cool, sure. And then all of a sudden we started winning more games and we were at least way more competitive. And it really, and in basketball, and I played soccer my whole life and I was always a sweeper.
Mm-hmm.
Makes perfect sense to me. Like, I'm running the show, but no one outside this team knows that. Like, that's how I saw the sweeper position. I'm dictating the flow of the game.
Right.
And I'm the last wall of defense before the goalie, but I'm also setting up the offense a lot and I'm barking out commands the whole time. And nobody on the sidelines knows a thing because I'm not scoring goals. And that's totally cool. And then I looked at the drummer like that too. I was like, you know, you're not Michael Jordan, you're Bill Russell. You know, you're protecting the rim and you're rebounding and you're throwing outlet passes and you're keeping that shit together. But everyone else is going to go dunk and shoot three-pointers. And that was like, yeah, great, perfect, let's go.
It seems like you assumed that role in your family to a certain extent too, as the one that kept everything together.
I just did that as a means of self-preservation. When you're the youngest, it's not like my older siblings are taking a cue from me on earth. I just got along with everybody. You know, it's like The only brother I ever really had any contentious moments with, it wasn't my brother who was right above me, Doug, but my brother Dave, who's 4 years older. We were both really into music. We had a lot of the same interests. And for whatever reason, that spurred a lot of arguments.
Right.
The brother in between us, he and I didn't share. I don't think we've ever had an argument because we have no common interests. It's a weird thing. But for the most part, there were some siblings that clashed over the years, but I never had any of those really. It was just it's easy being the baby on a certain level. You know, it's like kind of the golden child a little bit, you know, and not that my parents treated me like that, but the other siblings, it's kind of like whenever the last kid came out, that kid was always going to have a little extra room,
mm-hmm.
you know, and I never pushed it. I was always, once we moved to Kentucky, my four older siblings were like superheroes to me. I missed them so much. Like, I stopped seeing them as, oh, that's just Bob. But it was like, oh my God, it's Bob. You know, mm-hmm. They all took on these epic qualities to me.
When you were playing basketball,
mm-hmm.
did you have fantasies of becoming a professional basketball player in the same way that you were thinking about being a drummer?
No, me and my friends would shoot in the driveway and we'd be Dr. J and Magic and all that stuff like you do. But no, I never thought, I knew that was never in the cards. Like, that's physically not going to happen. Like, I'm slow of foot and I don't have a killer instinct. I'm not playing in the NBA. I always understood that. But the drumming thing too, I think about it sometimes and I think if I'd stayed in Maryland, I probably would have gotten a drum kit because I know that a lot of other kids were playing in garage bands. My brother was in one. I grew up watching him play Grand Funk covers in our garage. When I got to Kentucky, no one was doing that. And it didn't seem like, we went from like a, Severna Park is right next to Annapolis. It's 20 minutes sure. south of Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of people. It's a lot going on. Then we moved to a really small town of like 25,000 people. It's a very different vibe. Like, there's a town. There's a downtown. There's the mall. There's a lot of farms. There's you know, the town ends, and then you're in the middle of nowhere. You know, in Maryland where we were, it just goes on forever. It's just, and it just was a very different, the approach to everything in life was very different. Even at 10, I was really aware of that, you know, like, from one thing being like a neighborhood full of Catholic and Jewish families to suddenly it's all Southern Baptist and Catholics are like, you're what? What are you, you know, it was, everything was different about going to that small town. And I didn't see, I think I would have thought about playing in a band more. But when I got to Kentucky, a couple things happened. One, we went to a small private school that had a soccer team. We were the only soccer team for 50 miles. We had to go to Nashville to get a game. If I'd been at one of the public high schools, there probably were rock bands. But there was no one in my little school that was jamming on the weekends. That just didn't happen. And then I grew up and I was really the only kid into new wave and punk. A couple of my friends were, but I was really obsessed with it. And I just didn't understand, like, there's just no, how do you start a band? If I were a good basketball player, well, yeah, you play for your school, you go to college, you can see a path.
Right.
I didn't have any concept of how you become a band or start a band or do it. It was only when I got to college that I started seeing bands in clubs. Literally, as dumb as it sounds, like the first time I walked into the Exit Inn in Nashville and saw a band, I went, oh,
you can do it?
You could just do it.
Yeah.
And this, whatever that band was, they sucked. And I was like, oh my God, I can do this. You know, it's that simple. Like, oh, hang on. But then I still didn't immediately do it, you know, because I was in college and I was a broadcasting major and I thought I was going to be a sportscaster because I could see a path. But
you do have a very resonant voice.
Yeah. And I have a radio show.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm doing all these things. So that made sense too. You know, like if I had never dropped out and just become a sportscaster, that would have made perfect sense.
What made you drop out?
Well, because the only thing I wanted to do was be in a band. The more I was watching bands and going to see bands, and then my freshman year of college, my brother Dave and a couple friends that could actually play instruments, we played a New Year's Eve party. We formed a band for New Year's Eve. And we just learned like 10 songs. And I borrowed a drum kit and I was the drummer. And suddenly I play a party on New Year's Eve, my freshman year of college. And I'm like, okay. Like the party ended and I was like, hey, we're going to do this, right? We're like a real band. And the other guys are like, huh? I'm like, no, like we just played songs. Let's book shows. Let's do this. And they all were like, no, we're not doing that. But then we did it the next year. So for three straight New Year's Eves, I played a gig. That was it. Like, you know, in a 2-year span, I played 3 shows.
That's a very specific phenomenon that I remember too. When I started playing drums with people, I felt like everybody must be feeling the joy that I was feeling they would, you know, logically want to.
What else go could possibly all in? Occur to you?
Yeah, and they're exactly. like, no, we have girlfriends and we have other things that we want to do.
Yeah, well, these guys are like, I'm graduating in 6 months. What are you talking about? And I'm like, what do you mean?
Just like outmatching everybody else's enthusiasm.
Yeah. Yeah, so I, you know, so that was it. So my junior year after my third straight New Year's Eve party, by that time we had gotten a new, you know, it was different players every year. My brother was always the singer and I was the drummer and different people. And we were called Alfred and the Stately Wayne Manners, which was a pretty hip name in the late 80s. And it was actually a band that my brother had started with friends before I even got to college. They never played. They'd put up flyers, and then they'd put up flyers that they had to cancel the show. It was all a shtick. It was like performance art. But then finally, because he goes, well, you can play drums, so let's be a real band. So I just got in on the tail end of an old shtick that had already been running for years. But by my junior year in college, like the spring of 86... a couple of the friends of mine, my buddy Brent from Iowa and this guy John, this bass player, we all were in the same dorm and they could actually play. And so then we started playing at these parties in Bowling Green, Kentucky at the rugby house. We did a series of the rugby players had a house. They would have a keg on Friday nights and we would just go play. And these other guys could play any song you wanted, so I could fake any song by that point. And I'd literally, at this point, still been at a drum kit for 12 hours total in my life, all of them in front of people, like never rehearsed, really. And so that spring, my buddy Brent said, I wrote some songs. And so then I wrote these lyrics and he had songs. I put lyrics to him and he had a little Fostex 4-track tape recorder. And he goes, if we could ever find a place to play, we should record these. So in the Easter weekend of like 1986, me and my two friends drove back to my hometown and went into my high school gym. And my mom worked there and gave me the keys. And it's a small school. I knew everybody. We just went into the gym by ourselves and set up and recorded our 4 original songs. And so that's the first time I was ever recorded playing drums.
Natural reverb.
And a little bit. and we called our band Lack of Interest because we just, that was it. We weren't going to book gigs or anything. And so, but that way more than the parties. I mean, we did that and we're driving back to Bowling Green the next day and I'm going, guys, like, these are good. We can get a record deal. And they're both going to graduate a month later. They're looking at me like, what are you talking about? This is just cool to do. And I'm like, no, we can play gigs. Let's do this. Let's do this. And they weren't interested. And so that thing, that little recording session, if you will, that's when there was no turning back. Like that, I lost my mind after that. I was like,
hearing yourself back.
Yeah. I was like, oh my God, I can actually do this, you know? And I still have those songs. I mean, if you listen to them, it's like, I can feel there's a, it's not very good, but there's something there. I still think, like, I hear it and I'm like, I knew what I was trying to do. You know, I'm like, I had an idea. And so that whole summer of 86, I was just tormented by that. And then literally that September, my friend Clint calls and goes, hey man, you want to do this? And I was like, that's all. I just needed someone that wanted to do it with me. And I said, yep. But I didn't give it another thought. And I was there 3 or 4 months later.
There meaning in Atlanta.
Yeah, I moved to Atlanta.
You arrived in Atlanta and bought a $700 drum kit.
Yes, I did.
A Pearl.
Pearl Exports.
That was my first drum kit.
Yeah.
With some Scimitar.
Scimitar cymbals. Zildjian cymbals. Yeah, man.
And how did it feel to play that thing?
Like, I mean, it was like just, it was like a Ferrari. I mean, I was like, oh my God, man, this is... I knew enough to know these cymbals don't sound great, but they sounded perfect. I literally have goosebumps right now just thinking about, because I can remember the first time I set it up And the first time, my band was called Marry My Hope, and Clint and Sven, who Sven later ended up in the Black Crowes playing bass 10 years later, Clint and Sven and me, three guys in this living room, and we just started making noise for the first time. And that was literally living the dream. Like, I've never felt like that in my life. I've never felt that content.
Like, again?
I don't think I've ever been in a situation that I'd waited so long for. There's nothing I could do that could replicate that. Like, it's like,
what about having a kid or something?
I think I was more, I was an adult by the time I had a kid.
Yeah, I see.
I just knew more. Like, it was the perfect mix of being really naive and dumb, but knowing what I wanted. And it's all these things that you can't get when you're 35.
Right. And naivete is an essential ingredient to going on,
without question,
that artistic journey.
No, I mean, that first time we played together, Clint was showing us this song, and we started playing it within a few minutes. We're like, okay, so this is a verse, just find this groove. And I was playing it, and I'm just playing a really straight beat. And Sven and I kind of locked in, and we were just grooving. And then, like, we hit this pause, and we all laughed. Mm-hmm. Like, it was real, like, hey, all right. And that feeling was like, whatever the feeling for anyone's life is, it's like when you slip on the best pair of shoes you ever wore, whatever it is, the first time, it's not hyperbole, not the first time you have sex, but the first time you have good sex, or whatever it is, that thing, that was what that was. That was like, I knew I'd been waiting my whole life for it, but I didn't know I'd been waiting my whole life for that. It went beyond what I wanted or hoped for. It truly did.
Yeah, I sometimes think I've been chasing that feeling ever since I first got it.
Of course, yeah.
But that seems kind of sad, and it's like, well...
Well, it's only sad if you... There's a lot of feelings I can't get back and I don't want back.
Right.
Because if you still got them, it means you haven't learned anything, in a sense, or you're still kidding yourself. Like, that feeling was amazing, but I can say now, but as you said, a lot of the ingredients are naivete and hoping, and you know, how much of that was me kidding myself? It probably sounds like a grease fire, but it didn't matter, because in that particular moment, it meant so much to me that, like, because I came from all my high school friends and all my college friends, and then my family, my oldest siblings, when I said I'm dropping out of school to go to Atlanta and start a band, they all went, oh, that's awesome. I'm like, good, go for it. Why not? But the kids who were my own age, I had a lot of friends going, what are you doing? Like, dude, you can graduate, get your degree first.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, no, that defies the, if I get my degree first, I'll feel like I'm wasting it in a weird way. Or like, I can't do that. I have to quit now.
Or if you have a fallback plan, you'll fall back because it's too hard.
Yeah, that's it. And there's also a lot of, you know, it's the same thing too. If I knew what I was getting into, I would have never done it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I thought me, Clint, and Sven, having never played a note of music together, we're going to make it. It's like, it's absurd. But I really did believe that. And then when I left that band and joined Mr. Crow's Garden, I was like, we are going somewhere. By God, this thing is going to fucking happen. And
Mr. Crow's Garden was the predecessor to the Black Crowes.
It's what became the Black Crowes. It's the band that made Shake Your Moneymaker and then changed our name. It's the band.
And with those guys, you found other people that had that same attitude as you.
I mean, I can look back now and see how I misinterpreted certain things at the time. But what I felt from them was specifically from Chris, because Rich didn't really offer much in terms of what he was thinking or feeling. But with Chris, he was so desperate, you know, and there was a desperation that he wore on his sleeve that I would never have shown, but I felt every bit as much. I was always more understated, and I could keep things a little closer to my chest. But I was like, that's what, when we connected right away as friends, it was kind of like that. I was like, man, that guy acts like I feel. Mm. I mean, I'm not going to act like that, but I'm fucking on board, because he's gonna do whatever it fucking takes to get this off the ground and get somewhere. So I'm right there with him. Let's go. And I didn't feel that from Clint and Sven at the time. And I look back, and the funny thing is Marry My Hope, I played three shows with the band I moved to Atlanta to start, and then I quit and joined someone else's band, which my gut was telling me not. I hated that I was doing it. It went, I wanted my one band. I'm going with my friend Clint and Sven, and then I brought the singer down from Kentucky with me, and then I'm leaving them after three shows.
And then they got a record deal.
Dude, within 6 months, they were amazing. They were kicking the living shit out of Mr. Crow's Garden. But within a year, they were a big part of the Atlanta music. They were like a band people were like buzzing about like crazy. And we were not. And it was like, but, and as much as I was like, I could say, shit, I made the wrong choice. But I knew I hadn't, because they were way more ambitious. And musically, I felt like it was going to get away from me a lot faster. And Mr. Crow's Garden was, we were playing really straight, simple 3.5-4 minute songs that were all like, you know, somewhere between the Replacements and REM and the Long Riders and Green on Red. And all of these bands were pretty much everything was in 4/4. Just
which
a matter of how
comports with your square
yeah,
thinking.
Fuck yeah, it did. Mary My Hope was going all over the place and really epic, heavy, like, you know, real dark thematic epic songs. And I was like, I liked it, but it didn't feel like me.
And were you working at the record store at the time?
At this time, no. I was working. I had a bunch of odd jobs. I started working at the record store in like in 88, end of 88. I'd been in town like a year and a half, and then I got that job.
And how central to your identity was being in Mr. Crow's Garden?
Huge.
So yeah, that, like, yeah, if, yeah. If someone asked you what you did, you would say, I'm a drummer for this band.
Oh, yeah, I'm in a band. I worked at Fellini's Pizza, which was the other coolest job you could possibly have. And then I worked at Wax and Facts. And for a while, I was doing both. I was Wax and Facts at day, and then I go to Fellini's at night. And I was in a band. So
what did you do at the pizza place?
Oh, just make... I did everything but actually make the pies and calzones. Like, I did occasionally, but there was usually a guy that did that. I pulled stuff out of the oven, did slices and salads, and you order at the counter, and then you take the food out, then you bust the table. You just do mm-hmm. everything. Mm-hmm. 2 or 3 man shift. You know, that was it. And we just played loud music, and every guy that worked there was in a band for the most part, including the owner. So that was like the cool, that was the first, this will be the coolest job I ever had. And I got it, and it was. And you could just drink at work. And it was, you know, coming from Kentucky, and then all of a sudden I'm at Fellini's and we're listening to punk rock loud, serving pizza and drinking beer. I'm like, man, this is, I knew the whole time I was in college, there was this life out there I was supposed to be living.
So Kentucky represented some sort of repression to you?
Yeah.
But they make bourbon there.
It's my own, yeah, but it's of my own making.
Uh-huh. It was what you assigned, the value you assigned to Kentucky.
I didn't want to like Kentucky. Yeah. I wanted to get out of Kentucky. The minute I got there, I was like, I got to get back to Baltimore.
Mm-hmm.
And then that became at least Nashville, because there's cool clubs and see bands there. But Atlanta was like, oh, hell yeah, I'll go to Atlanta. This will be great. So, no, it's funny because I'm in Kentucky now all the time. I love it. I tell, you know, I'm from Kentucky. You know, it's like, that's where I tell people I'm from. But my years in college were spent, I was playing a ton of basketball and thinking about playing drums, wasting a Pell Grant, just hanging out with good friends. And I was dating a girl that she was really just my best friend. It wasn't like some epic romance. We were just inseparable because we made each other laugh, and I love her. She's a great friend of mine. And, you know, it was all perfectly cool, but I had this part of, I just had this thing like, man, I there's this other life I'm supposed to be living. And the only reason I wasn't was because I didn't just go down and make it happen. I just needed that call from, I needed someone like Clint. You know, I met people in college who said, let's start. I did meet guys who said, let's do this. But there was a thing I just, for whatever reason, I was like, nah, I'm cool. I was like waiting. I just had to be the right person to do it with. And that right person was Clint. And then that led to Mr. Crow's Garden. And then it's, you know, it just took off. Well, as soon as I got to Atlanta, though, I was like, I hit the ground running. I got a job as a doorman at a bar. And then it closed. And I went to Fellini's. And then I got Wax and Facts. And in between, I had a couple other weird jobs. But the whole time, I mean, from the day I got there, I was like, I'm in a band. It's called Mary My Hope. And then I'm in a band called Mr. Crow's Garden. And I mean, that's what I was. And nothing was going to stop that. And, you know, we used to look at other local bands and they'd rehearse like really regimented rehearsals, and they had schedules and they had plans, and we had none of that. You know, rehearsals always devolved into Monty Python talking about so many things we could be talking about. We, you know, me and Chris would go see, we went to see Full Metal Jacket. And so, like, walked out of the movie theater, got back to the house, And Rich turned up and we were like, we can't rehearse. We just saw the new Stanley Kubrick film. I mean, that's how we operated. Like, no, we have to drink and talk about this movie. Sorry. I mean, but those are the
And that's something that a band does that a group doesn't do.
That's exactly right.
Yeah.
And I was going to say, that bonds, that makes things really sticky between people.
Well, you were developing a collective aesthetic at the time and a collective language.
Entirely. And Rich wasn't around for it nearly as much, but when he was, he certainly picked up on all that. You know what I mean? Like, we were just looking at it by the clock. Like, he's never here. But when he was there, he was very much a part of that. Like, me and Chris were inseparable in those local band days. And we were always out, always, you know, at one point we were dating girls and they had to be friends because we were never going to be apart. And then we would always just, oh, it's too bad, you know, fucking Rich, he never wants to be, you know, that. But then he'd show up and that's when it would, but we even knew like, oh, well now this is the band. Like, that was a different aesthetic. It was more and it meant more, but we just didn't have it as much. You know mm-hmm. what I mean? Like, that's how it felt to me anyway.
Yeah, it's like a family that happens to make music together.
Yeah.
If you didn't have a regimented rehearsal schedule and you didn't really spend that much time playing by yourself, how did you get good?
But like 1988, we all got really good together. The band really had a boom. We met George Draculius, who was working for A&M Records, and we met him and immediately we connected with him in a way that we had never thought about another record label guy. We had met record label guys, and the first time
And George, played, for people that don't know, he and Rick Rubin, I think, shared a dorm room, and
NYU.
He worked for Def Jam, and then ultimately went to Def American and signed you guys later on.
Yeah, we met. So I'll even go back further. The first thing I ever did with Mr. Crow's Garden was a demo for A&M Records. They had already gotten a guy from LA to give them money to go in and do a demo. And so, I mean, I'd been playing for 3 months and then I'm in a studio in North Carolina and thinking, how the fuck did I get here? But the producer, Steve Grombach, was great. He just said, I remember he said, you just got to find the pocket. And I remember I said, okay, what's that? You know, and he said, no, man, just lay it down. Don't worry about fills. Just hit cymbal crashes at the end of the choruses. Like, he literally paint by numbered me through it. But then I played it and then we listened back and I was like, I'm okay, man. You know, like, as long as I stay in the lines, I'm pretty good at this. So I had that going for me. But, you know, at the same time, I'm seeing bands every night. And right away, there was a band called 86, a local band in Atlanta. And the drummer is Mac McAnally, who's in, like, the Jesus Lizard later. So
he was on this show.
Dude, I mean, I saw that band and I was like, I have to go back to college. I'm fucking kidding myself. And I saw a band called Dash Rip Rock. And their drummer, Fred LeBlanc, is now head of the band called Cowboy Mouth for years. He's the singer and the drummer at Cowboy Mouth. When he was in Dash Rip Rock, I saw him doing full Pete Townsend windmills with both hands keeping a straight beat, full on, as hard as I've ever seen anyone hit drums. And I just thought, what am I doing? I'm kidding myself. Like, all these drummers are just amazing. But I still had that sense of, no, but I'm just me. I mean, but they're all just being them, and I'm just doing what I do.
That's pretty mature for a young person.
Yeah. Well, I had a sense of, well, it could have been a way to mask my rampant insecurity, but I also did have a sense of, I felt at 21, I thought I was 35 in relative terms. I'm so late to the game, you know, because I'm in a band with a 19 and an 18-year-old or whatever they were, and they've already been playing clubs for a year. Like, shit, I'm even behind these guys. And Rich is 4 years younger than me, and he's already been doing this for 2 years when I joined. So I knew I had to make up a lot of ground. But so what I also knew was, well, I can't afford to fuck up. I have to be as efficient. My learning curve has to be really efficient. And I did also, I noticed the confidence thing right away. The drummers that I would see, I could tell immediately if they were wavering with confidence. And I was like, okay, don't do that. Just fucking go, man. Like, I'm not going to let that happen. And then I just thought, like I said, I knew I was really smart in that I thought, well, as long as I'm not bad, I'm going to be good. Like, just, I first thing I wanted to establish was my basement. You know, the lowest I can go, if that's always at least just good, then I'm fine. Like, Because, you know, I'm watching drummers and they're great. And then they just go for some fill and they totally lose the one. And I'm hyper aware of it. And so I'd be like, okay, I'm never going to do that. I'm never, ever going to. And I wouldn't. I mean, I would play entire shows with four fills. 12 mm-hmm. songs, four drum fills. Mm-hmm. But every night everybody goes, hey, man, you're fucking solid. I mean, right away I was like, I just can't. And I didn't think of it like in a linear way. I felt it like I have to be the cement floor. Because, you know, the other guys are fucking up intros. Rich's solos can be wonky. Chris forgets the word. You know, that can all happen. But if I fuck up, the whole thing just falls apart.
Yeah. So
and I took that on like it was a point of pride. Like, I'm not going to fuck this up.
In your book, you describe Chris's role as the architect and Rich's role as the guy that supplies the lumber and the right. supplies. So yeah. Your role would be what? The cement guy?
I'm like digging the ditch so you can put the pipes in the ground. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But yeah, so you don't want to dig like fanciful ditches. You just dig the fucking ditch and put the pipes in.
I just had that innate sense of, I think having been in Mary My Hope, who were right away trying to like they replaced me with a drummer. And the first time I saw them, they played Rock and Roll by Led Zeppelin. And I'm like, and he killed the intro and the outro. And I went, oh, fucking thank God I'm not in this band right now. I wasn't ready to go up and do that. Like, I could play it. I could have gotten my way through it in the living room. I would have had a real hard time doing that, you know, in a club in 1987. So my confidence had its limits. I just knew that in the world of Mr. Crow's Garden, I just willed myself to be the only drummer that made sense in that band. That's how I saw it. Like, I have to be this unimpeachable as far as, you know, I didn't fuck that up.
When you started recording, mm-hmm. did you feel like your obsessive compulsive stuff came into play?
It was incredibly... it was a handicap at first, and then it became a great strength.
How did it become?
For my playing in general, I'm so hyper aware of when I'm a little behind finding the one. You know, I do a fill and I come out ahead or behind. Trust me, I know it like before it happens. It's like, duh! No one else notices, but it's like an nth degree. I can feel it. And that's not necessarily next to a metronome, but my personal rhythm, you know, my own sense of time. As long as I'm, you know, if I'm where I need to be within that, I'm great. But I always know when it would be off. So when we were making Shake Your Moneymaker, I'd never played to a click track. And again, the dreamer in me got in the way. I'm like, I'm in there trying to make sticky fingers. I'm like, I got to lay this down like Charlie on Sway or something. It's like, stop, Steve. You've been playing for 2 years. And George was telling me...
Well, hold on a second. So that's kind of remarkable that you'd only been playing for 2 years and here you are making a record.
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty crazy.
That's nuts.
Did it feel...
Yeah, I bought that kit in March of 87 and we started tracking in June of 89.
And then it became a record that millions of people bought and enjoyed.
Yeah. And by the time it came out, I was already way better because I'd had 8 more months of playing. I mean, I was still getting better and better and better. And then 2 years after that, it was like...
Yeah, I mean, you'd already added 30% of experience.
Yeah, it's like when you have a baby and you're like, or you see...
I would know that,
well,
but yeah.
If you see a kid who's 3
yeah.
and then you see another kid who's 3.5, once you're a parent, you're like, the difference is huge in where those kids are developmentally. And so, yeah, 2 years and 2.5 years for me as a drummer was pretty significant. So when we were first making that record, I was like the dream, you know, another thing. Oh my God, we're making a record. This is a real thing. This is the real deal. And the first couple days, 3 days, we didn't get anything done. We hadn't gotten any tracks we could use. And we were just ridiculous. We had no ability to just laugh and go, oh, fuck. You know, we couldn't just air it all out and make each other feel okay. It was always... Get your shit together, dude. I got my shit together. What's wrong with you? It would just be everybody internalized all of our own angst and insecurities. And it just was, we were paving all these horrible roads right out of the gate, you know, for how we would act as a band throughout the 90s. But then again, once we got one track, suddenly we had like 6 in 3 days. You know, like once I figured it out, and I tell this story in the book, but George kept saying like, you're falling off the click. It's so stupid. He would say, you're falling off the click, which to me implied I'm slowing down. That's what falling off means to me. I was rushing, and he kept telling me, you're getting ahead. He didn't say you're getting in front of the time. He kept saying you're falling off.
Right.
And it literally took 3 days for us to air it out and him say, stop speeding up. And I go, you keep telling me I'm falling off. And he goes, yeah, you're falling off. You're going too fast. And it literally, like, I think I actually cried because I just was so frustrated. And I walked in the next day and started getting tracks, like boom, boom, boom. They all started coming because I was like, oh. Because I was pushing because I thought he was telling me I was going slow and I was losing my mind. I'm like, there's no fucking way I'm going slower than this goddamn click.
Being in a studio and feeling like you're out of your element is the most stressful situation.
It was.
Because you're putting all of your hopes and dreams into this, and all of your self-worth is coming from your ability to do this. And then if you can't,
of course,
it really fucks you up.
Oh, I was thinking, I mean, I was literally sitting there thinking about it going, if they decide I can't do this, and I knew, I was like, if I don't play on the record, I'm not staying in the band. They'll just look right at me and go, well, we got to get a drummer that can keep up. I mean, that's exactly what we had just done with our bass player. You know, Scott Shamel, a guy that we loved, he could not play the tracks solid enough. He was a really sloppy bass player. And when George said, our producer told us, he goes, hey, Scott's great, but we need to bring someone else in for the album. And I with the brothers were like, well, then no, let's get a real bass player. Like, we're trying to be great. And if he can't play on this album, we're all just at the starting first lap. Let's find a real bass player then. And so 2 months later, I'm going, oh shit, they're about to do this to me. And they won't. And I'm like Chris's best friend, and I'm about to lose my job in this band. So when all of a sudden I broke through and we got a track done, I was like, oh, I went right from complete implosion to full confidence, like that. I just needed that one. And then all of a sudden I was like, I got this. And then we started getting the songs, you know, 2, 3, 4 takes. Good. Great. Next. And we just knocked them all out really fast after that. That was the last time I ever had a feeling of, I can't keep up. I'm in trouble. But I definitely, towards the end of the Shake Your Moneymaker tour, I was feeling like I gotta get a lot better. I've learned how to do all this backwards. Like, I'm already playing, like we're headlining theaters and I'm totally delivering this shit. But there's a lot of little things, like I didn't know how to just do like a basic triplet to end a song. Like, I'm like, wait, is that snare, rack, floor, or is it snare, rack, kick? How do those guys do that? Like a real drummer just goes da 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 da,
spit'em.
And I would literally, like, I didn't know how to do that. And I'm headlining theaters, you know. I'm aware of, and like, we're playing Dreams by the Allman Brothers in Memphis and in front of 40,000 people with Greg Allman. And I'm like, I don't even know what I'm playing it, but I don't even know what this is called. I just need to sit down with someone to tell me a few. I knew there was, like, I was doing things harder than they needed to be done. You know, I was like, I'm kind of winging all this shit and I'm making it work, but I didn't, but I could tell, like, okay, I'm now at a point where I need a little education.
So what did you do?
Nothing. I just kept playing gigs, but we went into the studio a little before that. We did some demos looking ahead in LA in early 1991. We'd been on the road for a year. And the first time I got back in the studio after touring for a year, that's when I realized how far I'd advanced. I was like, oh, wait, hold on a minute. Like, I'm adding ghost strokes now and they don't get in the way. They actually help. And just little things in my playing, and like, oh, I don't have to hit so hard. Oh, microphones. Let's let them do their job. And all this stuff I didn't think about once on Shake Your Moneymaker, a year later or a year and a half later from that session, after being on the road for 12 months, I went back and listened to the demos we did. And I was like, holy shit. Okay. I didn't notice, but I'm getting pretty good. And then when we made our second record, that was just like, forget it, man. We're off and running. But I always knew I was good in the context of the Black Crowes. Like, I always said, like, I'm the best drummer in the world as long as it's these five guys in the room with me.
Right.
That's all I cared about. Mm-hmm. I had no interest in, you know, I'm not trying to impress anybody. I'm just trying to be great in my band.
Yeah, I think that there was like a prototype advanced in like modern drummer in the 70s and 80s where the ideal drummer is supposed to be able to play every style and play with any musician and work in any situation. But it doesn't make sense. It's like, well, you don't need to be a father in every family. You can be a father in one family, or if you're especially adventurous, maybe two families.
Yeah, right. But, no, I always, well, and I've said this for years, and it's very true. Like, I think I'm great. And anytime someone tells me that, I'm like, oh, thanks. I'm stunned. Oh, you noticed too? Because my greatness was always, it's a product of the whole.
Mm-hmm.
It's like the Black Crowes for a time there, were a great band, and I was a big part of the reason why. There were six people that made that band great. So there's only six guys that can take credit, and I'm one of them. So fuck yeah, I'm great. But I didn't care about it beyond that context. That was it. That's truly it. So that said, I can go sit with anybody right now. I mean, at this point, it's a kind of a moot thing. But I do play with a lot of different people, and I jam with people, and I can do a lot of stuff. But the way I say it is, look, I just play like me, and I fake like everything else I got to do. You know, like, mm-hmm. I'm good at faking a lot of different styles, but mm-hmm. I know the difference between the guys that really do it and the guys like me that can simulate it. You know what I'm saying? Like, mm-hmm. there's certain things mm-hmm. that, you know, I'm as aware of my strengths and my limitations. I'm more aware of that than anybody, and I've always been very honest with myself about that. I've never thought, oh, I'm at a place now where I can do anything. It's like, oh no, shit, let me figure out how to do this so it works.
Yeah, going back to Ringo, I mean, people give Ringo a lot of shit, people that don't know about
music. Nobody that music. I have any respect for.
But he does get a lot of shit, and historically he did.
It's
you know,
insane.
But, you know, they always say a band is only as good as its drummer.
Yeah.
And that's true. But I also think that the inverse is true. I mean, a drummer is really only as good as the band or the people that they play with.
Of course.
And part of it is like selecting the right people to suit your style.
See, I think that's the whole thing. And I mean, in a sense, it's like, because as much as we're kind of laughing about younger naivete and the dreamer and all this stuff, but there really is an alchemy to great bands. There is a chemistry that you can't force, you can't recreate it. It's just there. And if you're smart enough to figure it out while it's happening, then you're off and running and nothing can stop you. People can say, I don't like the band, but they can't deny that it's a real band.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all you can hope for. And the Beatles, you know, yeah, they had the songs.
Yeah.
Kind of a big part of it. They had the best songs that anybody had ever come up with at the time, and they had dozens of them and all that shit. But, you know, if you go back and listen to the live stuff from 63 and 64, they're just incredible. That Ron Howard documentary, did you see that? 8 days a week?
No, I didn't see
it. You have to see it. There's some footage of them in 64 where that I saw her standing there from that DC show right after Ed Sullivan. It's unreal. If you walked into a club tonight and saw that band, you'd call everyone you knew and said, you have to come see this band.
Mm-hmm.
There's just nothing
like
it.
It was undeniable.
It's undeniable. And that chemistry is, it's, you know, and Ringo Starr was, he's serving three songwriters.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's not like most bands. No, bands don't have George Harrison in the three hole. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, it takes a pretty special guy to handle all of that, what that required.
And well, you talked about Ticket to Ride. I mean, the drum part is just as integral to that as anything else. It's a hook.
Well, how many Beatles songs can, not you or me, but can the guy walking down the street, can you, anybody that's my age anyway, I'm 54, how many Beatles songs can you just play the drum track and they go, oh, that's, I know what that is.
Or you could even sing the drum track. That's what's so great about it is you could actually sing anything that he plays because it's so melodic.
He's a musician playing drums. And like I've always said, I don't play drums, I play music. I mean, I don't mean that like it's an arrogant thing.
But that's your intention.
That's my intention. That's always, I'm bored to death playing a drum kit by myself. It takes me 20 minutes and then I'm like, I can't do this anymore. Like I'll get an idea and I have to go work it out. And that's amazing. But once I have it, I'm done. Like I at least give me a bass player. Let me make noise with someone else and I'll sit there all damn day.
Mm-hmm.
But playing by myself to just keep in shape or to just work on a million fills I'm never going to use. It just drives, no interest in it. I just love playing songs.
It's like dancing by yourself.
Yeah. That's how I look at it.
Yeah. Or trying to have a conversation without anybody in the room.
But I've done that. It's not very rewarding.
One of the kind of turning points in the book for me is when your manager told you to go out and buy the book Codependent No More.
Yeah. Because
the whole time I was thinking about the relationship that you had with the brothers. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, like one of the kind of central themes of the book is how the band had a special alchemy that you happened to be in the right place at the right time and find one another.
Yep.
And then have, and then also the sound coalesced at a time that radio and other people were receptive to it. And the record business was suited to what you guys were doing.
Yeah.
But then, so you had that and then basically proceeded to fuck it all up over and over again as a band.
Oh yeah. Is
there anything that you think you could have done differently if you knew now what you, if you knew then what you knew now, or
not in terms of how to fix the narrative of the band? I could have just taken much better care of myself. That's the only thing I could have done differently.
How did your abuse, like your self-abuse, manifest at the time?
I just drank.
Mm-hmm.
Drank a lot. There was a ton of drugs in the band and none of them worked for me. I tried them all and was like, doesn't work. I don't like it. It made things, it always made it worse. I could drink and I was never an angry or sad drunk. I mean, I could be more sad if it was appropriate, obviously. You know, you get bad news and you got six beers in you, it's much easier to cry that way. But I wasn't a guy, I was generally in a good mood. Like I'd have a couple beers and be like, okay, just chill. You know, it's like a total, I need some perspective, so I'm going to have a few beers and just chill the fuck out. I mean, that's what it did for me. And then by 97, that was the first time I went, okay, I'm like a fucking drunk. I've got to stop drinking like this. This is no longer doing its job. And that was also just reflective of the darkness had just consumed the band. It was just not possible to have a really good time. There were always a lot of laughs. There's always moments, even at the worst points between me and Chris, there could be something where we'd be just laughing our ass off 5 minutes later together. And like, I mean, literally,
that's
like,
what makes it so funny,
just
though, right?
Looking at each other and just knowing what each other's thinking and just dying laughing.
Yeah.
I was aware of it even at the time, but I wasn't about to try to change it because I needed it. But that was fueled by, now that desperation was not, we needed those laughs because the rest of it was so dark and sad and angry. So when you find a moment that's funny, you really make sure it's funny. You know, like comedy comes, you know, every comedian.
Gallows humor and whatever.
That's what I mean. Like, you know, like how many comedians are coming from a place of tremendous pain?
Mm-hmm.
Our comedy, our shtick, all the band's internal shtick, the things that we just did within ourselves, those things were so necessary because without those, we would have all just wanted to jump off a bridge. You know, it's really what it was.
What was your state of mind during a normal day? Like for people that haven't toured, 90% of the time, you're just sitting around in a bus or a car or a venue. So what was going through your mind? And
we were always in hotels. Like mm-hmm. we would take a bus and, you know, we would from this, you know, really from the second half of the first album, we got to the point when once we got our own rooms in hotels, which by 1991, we were not sharing rooms anymore. We'd finish a gig, hang out in the dressing room for 30 minutes or 2 hours, depending on how many friends we had that we wanted to get drunk with or hang out with, get on the bus, go to the next town. And if it was a 2 hour drive or a 6 hour drive or whatever it was, we went straight to a hotel and you either woke up and then went into a room or you were still up and you went into a room. And then we stayed in that hotel till 4 o'clock the next day. And at 4 o'clock, you get on that bus and go to soundcheck every day without fail. And so every day, whenever I woke up, by 1992, 93, I just stayed in my room until four. I just stayed in my room by myself, talked to my wife on the phone. She was my girlfriend back then. I talked to a couple of my brothers. I'd call friends. I'd watch a movie. I just stayed just, you know, go out and get something to eat maybe, but I'd be in my room, in my own space, reading a lot, just anything to just get my head away from the band, but then also to just kind of slowly put on the armor, because I'm about to get on that bus at 4, and somewhere when I least expect that, something's going to erupt, and I'm going to have to put out a fire, or the fire's going to be on me, or who knows what. And then some days we just have a totally easy, peaceful, fun day. And it was just like, that was fucking great. And then by the next day, you're like, okay, where's it coming from today? There was always tension. And it started always with the brothers. It's not like me and Johnny weren't fighting, you know, like me and Mark Ford weren't ever at each other's throats. It always stemmed from the brothers. But it just leaks into every pore of the body of the band. I mean, everything is consumed by it, because any decision made, if everyone's, it could be a song in the set list. It could be, we're writing a song at soundcheck. I think the chorus should double. I think you should double that chorus. I think we should get Taco Bell tonight. Whatever the conversation was, if the brothers were on opposite sides of that argument and you weighed in one way, the guy who you went against said, you're just taking his side. And it's like, no, I'm voicing my opinion and it's not yours. That doesn't mean I'm aligning with him, but everything was alignment, and you know, the alliance is shifted with the wind at all times. And it was just, you know, and if it's like a family, when you have an addict, there's codependency, a culture's formed, there's a lot of secrets, everyone's embarrassed about shit that happens, and the last thing you want is anybody outside that bubble to know, because what does that say for you for putting up with it? You don't know this consciously. It's not linear thoughts, but this is what everyone feels. Everyone feels this. The addict is embarrassed. They know they're acting like a crazy person, but they can't stop it. And then it just swirls and swirls and swirls. And in our family, we were selling millions of records. And everybody you know is coming to your show every night. You're seeing friends, and this is their big night out. I had friends from high school and middle school and college and every walk of life I'd ever been in, and they're coming out and they're propping me up, and they're just like, oh my God. And I'm like, yeah, it was awesome. But then we are having great shows. Like, I'd walk off stage like, it's all okay. The show was great. But when we would have a bad night, I mean, it was awful. I mean, just like the vibe would be terrible. And a bad night to us was just a couple of missed cues and a missed opportunity. The crowd never knew. The 4,000 people stomping and screaming in unison meant nothing to the Black Crows. Mm. We'd walk in the dressing room and be tearing each other up over who fucked up that turnaround and whatever. The crowd had no idea, but we didn't care. It was all that kind of shit. And so that vibe becomes familiar pretty quickly. You just get used to it because you have to steel yourself, and then you're like, okay, I got this. And then familiarity becomes comfort. You get confused, and suddenly you confuse what's comfortable with what's familiar, and then it's over. Then the die is cast, and then you've just got a toxic culture, and then you're just off to the races.
Yeah, and you can also rationalize it as the essential cost being great. Well, because look at the Stones, look at Led Zeppelin, look at all these other people
and we did that
whose world you were actually not inside of when it was happening, but you're projecting that onto them too.
And we did it to such a level that I was around. You're around enough bands to you can immediately vibe out another band's world. You can see it right away, and I knew no band's a picnic. You know, every band has a level of whatever. Mm-hmm. We were so enamored with the idea of being one of those bands, being one of those all-time bands. And we all at least initially had a sense of, doesn't matter, as long as we're, you know, greatness is the goal. We're all going to go crazy getting there. It's fine. Like, we literally just accepted deplorable, interaction. And terrible. We treated each other horribly. Mm-hmm. And everybody can look back in themselves and go, God, what, you know, and to varying degrees. I mean, and when I say we, I just can't help but say that. But we allowed the toxic nature of the brothers' view of the world, their sense of entitlement, all of the things that they brought, good and bad, it all goes into the mix. And then again, you add it, here I am, I'm Johnny codependent. Let's go, I'll fix it, I'll make it okay. I got this. And then suddenly when everything is telling me, you should be in a different environment, I'm like, no, I'm not gonna let them beat me. Then my jock head comes in and I'm like, no, fuck you, I'll beat them. Mm-hmm. What a stupid way to go through life. You know, I was like, what do you mean I'm going to beat them? I'm in a band with them. This is nuts. And it just, and then like, you know, go play a great gig and let's all get drunk and pass out and it's all okay. You know, it just, it's like rinse, lather, repeat, whatever, you know, just, and.
Was there ever any indication as to why the brothers hated each other so much? I mean, in your book, you talk about early on going with Chris back to his parents' house, hanging out in their nice house. The dad takes you out in his Mercedes to get Chinese food and have a perfectly nice family dinner. Like, was it just some sort of in?
I don't know. I mean, yeah, they're very much alike. They act entirely different. You know, I've always said they're two sides of the same coin. You know, and Chris is just, you know, in your face, energy, loud. Rich is the exact opposite. But once you get to know them, I always thought they think, they receive information, and very similarly. They have a lot more in common than they don't. But I don't know. I don't know what started it or where. I just know that it was already, when I met them, that's just what it was. It was already going on. The difference is there were no stakes. We were just a local band. Rich was still living at home. He was a senior in high school the first time I played with him, or he just graduated. Mm-hmm. He's still living at home. Chris is in town with me and Clinton Sven in a house. We'd get together and play a gig, but then you go a week without seeing each other, or 3 days. Me and Chris didn't ever go that long, but we wouldn't see Rich for a week or two at a time sometimes. And then, you know, as much as they could be bashing heads, man, you know, Raising Arizona comes on and suddenly they're just thick as thieves. They know every line. They're laughing their ass off together. The first time I watched it with them, I hadn't seen it before. And I'm like, you know, I'm like anybody. I'm like, oh my God, how have I not seen this movie? This is the greatest thing I've ever seen. And we all have that. You know, it's like, but then again, there's all these breaks. Once we got on a bus and we're just never apart, you know, the brothers have a fight and they just go to different parts of the bus as opposed to different houses, you know, and it can flare up and it can flare up. And then it's just, I don't know where it came from. I just know that once it got going, once we were selling millions of records, you know, the grunge bands that came right behind us were freaked out by their success and they had no problem admitting it. And they had no problem talking about the fact that, man, this is kind of bullshit and this isn't what I was expecting. We felt that way and we didn't admit it. We thought we were pussies if you act like you're scared now or whatever the mentality was. It was like, hey, we picked up the ball. We're going to run it in the end zone. And we're supposed to be giant rock stars. We're supposed to be the biggest band in the world. But we didn't feel that way. You know, we were all in a band because of club bands. We weren't, none of us, the brothers didn't put Mr. Crow's Garden together because of Aerosmith and the Stones. They liked R.E.M. And they like the Long Riders, you know. And I wanted to be in a band. The first time I saw R.E.M., before Murmur even came out, I was like, I got to be in a band. And that was the height of success to me. You know, I saw the Swimming Pool Cues in 1986 at the Rites of Spring at Vanderbilt University playing in a field to 1,000 people. And it might as well have been the Beatles to me. I was like, I got to do this, man. You know, and we're making Shake Your Moneymaker talking about, we want to sell 50,000 records. We got to get 50,000. Then they'll let us make another one. Mm-hmm. Well, we sold 5 million copies and we're on MTV every fucking 5 seconds. And every rock station in America is playing the shit out of us. We weren't listening to rock radio in 1989. We weren't watching MTV. If we did, we did it to make fun of those bands. And then we were that band. And instead of having nuanced conversations about, well, how do we navigate this without selling our souls and without fucking it up, we just went out and acted a way that was wholly inauthentic and unnatural to all of us. Because we all had very, that's, I think success is ultimately a mirror. And we never sat down and looked in it together and said, okay, hold on, let's just talk. You know, there was no time to do that. We were not interested in any level. As much as I could have understood intellectually, this is a good idea, I wasn't about to open that door. I wasn't going to suggest it. I wasn't ready to face myself yet. I didn't want to know why I was feeling weird about it. I just felt weird about it and thought, well, fuck, whatever. Band's great. It's pretty simple, you know?
It's easier when you're making a lot of money to insulate yourself from reality,
well,
too.
Well, of course. I wrote it in the book. I bought a Range Rover, and I fucking felt like an asshole driving it. I couldn't even enjoy it, which now I'm like, well, you went out and you broke through. Whether it's luck or not, it wasn't. You know, I always say we were lucky. It doesn't mean we didn't earn it. We worked our ass off and we got really good. But you still need a million things to go your way that you're not controlling.
To even be in a group of people that you're aligned with, where you have the ability to work hard towards a common goal, that requires luck.
So much luck. I mean, and the culture of our band was, if someone said, man, you guys got lucky with that first album, it'd be like, oh, fuck you, we're great. You know, and it's like, oh, fucking stop, please. You know, that was kind of the
attitude. Not acknowledge luck is a curse. That's going to take you down real fast.
Well, and that's a big, that's a very, very accurate statement.
It almost would have been better for you if you would have just sold 50,000 records of that first
one. I don't think
there's
any question, because we could have, you know, the truth is we also didn't.
Or 5,000.
Well, we didn't go out. We had the longest run of dates we ever played before our album came out was 4 shows in a row. Yeah. That was it. We did weekends. Mm-hmm. We didn't tour. We didn't have a. Shake Your Moneymaker came out in February of 90. We met our manager in December of 89. We'd never had an agent. We never had a manager. We never had a clue. And suddenly we're out on a national tour opening for Junkyard, and we're just 6 weeks all around the country. And then we do another tour opening for MSG, and then we're opening for Aerosmith. Like, we're in arenas 4 months after that album was released. And like, okay. Like, we'll take advantage.
I guess this is how it works.
This is how it works.
Your manager is a central figure in your book, and he seems like such a savvy guy that can wear lots of hats. I mean, I believe he started off as a graphic designer and lighting designer, correct?
He was Van Halen's lighting guy. He was basically their visual, you know.
But he made their logo too, right?
Yeah, and they met him when they were an unsigned band. He was running the spotlight at the Whiskey A Go-Go. As a film student, just working working a club gig to make money. So he worked with them from the time they got signed. He was there. And then when they went on tour, he was their lighting director. I mean, he designed all their light shows and did all that, and then directed all their videos. And then by the time the 1984 tour came around, he was their de facto manager. And then was off with David Lee Roth. He was, you know, Dave was going to make a movie called Crazy from the Heat.
Mm-hmm.
And Warner Brothers was backing it, and he and Pete are in Mexico scouting locations. Pete's going to direct a film starring David Lee Roth, and then all of a sudden they get a phone call: "Oh, the band just fired you, Dave." You know, and he went with Dave, stayed with Dave as his manager, and so he just had David Lee Roth, which he guided to a ginormous solo career for the late part of the '80s, and then when he met us, we were just his other. He had Dave and us, and he was the only guy. You know, all these managers were sent our record and no one heard it. They were all like, yeah, I don't get it. I don't like it. And he heard it one time and called and said, I want to see the band.
And lots of managers are crooks. You guys lucked out finding somebody
listen, across the board, we never had this. The hard luck stories of so many bands is that exact thing.
Mm-hmm.
We found a manager who was willing to work harder than we ever were, who was more creative than any of us ever were, and understood business in a way none of us ever could. We had that guy. And we listened to him for 2 albums, and the results speak for themselves. and then it became impossible. Then we were never on the same page again.
In the book, you talk about leaving the band and how it was a weight off of your shoulders.
Oh, yeah.
But it was also central to who you are as a person, or who you had identified as for a long time. What did you do next? And did you feel like shedding that part of your identity was liberating, or was it scary, or both?
No, it was Well, so I called our manager in 1999. I was ready to quit in 99. And I called Pete to quit. And he laughed at me because he said, oh, Jimmy Page wants to tour. And suddenly I'm not quitting. A lot of things happen. Now it's 2 years later in 2001. And I'm really ready. Now I'm going to quit for real. So I did at the end of 2001. I quit the band. And all I felt was just no anxiety at all. It was just, whoa. And I still had that sense of, I'll figure it out. Something's going to happen. I don't know what my course is, but I'm going to, I figured this one out. I'm going to make sense of it. It'll work.
Were you independently wealthy at the time?
Not independently wealthy, but independently secure.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, compared to the kid that moved to Atlanta, I was very wealthy. But in terms of what real wealth is, no, but I was fine. I knew I had several years where I could just take my time and figure something out.
That's great.
I wasn't sweating it in 2001. So, and we were living in Brooklyn at the time. We moved to LA right away, just for a variety of reasons. We had another baby coming, and we were in an apartment, and the concept of New York City and unemployment and two babies in an apartment, all of it, and it was right after 9/11. I was like, my wife was definitely like, let's get the hell out of here. And so we came to LA thinking very wisely, we're going to have a toddler and a newborn. Good weather is going to make it a lot easier. Like, rain and snow suck with babies. And so we moved out here. We moved to Sherman Oaks and got set up, and we're waiting for the new baby to come. And I did have an idea. I wanted to do some writing, like not music. I wanted to write either like comedy or short stories, or had a TV show idea. And I knew a lot. I knew some people. I had friends who were writers in Hollywood. And so I was like, had been talking to them for a while. And I came out here and I met an agent, and right away he's like, oh man, let me see what you got. And he goes, yeah, let's sit you with some writers and just get you in a room and see what we can come up with. So within a few months of moving here, I was working with a guy named Jeff Cesario. He's a comedy writer and a former drummer. He's a percussionist. And he had written on Larry Sanders and Dennis Miller and all this great stuff. He's won all these Emmys. And so we immediately start writing a show about the music industry together, you know, and we clicked, and that was awesome. And then the other thing that happened, and this started the day I came to LA, I quit the band in December, and I'm here in late January to look for just to do a scouting trip for neighborhoods. And then as it turned out, I found a house right away, and we moved a month later. But so I met a realtor, and the day I land at LAX, I drive to the Valley, and I get out of this house I'm going to look at, and the realtor is a friend of our manager, Pete's, and she walks up to me, and we had talked on the phone. She goes, hey, how you doing? Good to meet you. How you doing? She goes, oh, before I forget, I was just with Slash, and I told him I was meeting you, and he said to give you his number, and he wants you to call him. And I'd been in town for an hour and a half. And I was like,
that's how LA works.
And I was like, this is a good start. Like, yeah. I was just laughing about it. I called Slash the next day. And 6 weeks later, we're jamming in his rehearsal space. And so we did that for a few months. A couple times a week, we'd get together, just me and him. Because he was just trying. He had a bunch of ideas, and he just wanted to do something totally different. And he just didn't want to play with the same kind of drummers he always seemed to play with, is what he told me. And we just had a blast. And it was a... It was really helpful, because at the time I probably would have started to feel a little like, okay, I'm 6 months out of the band. What's happening? Well, I was just jamming with Slash and meeting all these people through him. And in 2002 in LA, when word is out that you and Slash are cooking something up, man, all of a sudden people are like, I'm like, hey man, well, do you want to come play with me now? And it was leading to all these other things just as it was. So I was making no effort whatsoever to get stuff going, and shit was going. So that felt great. And then a kid named Joe Firstman had signed a deal with Atlantic Records, a young songwriter. And I got a note from his manager trying to track me down. He wants me to play in his record. And I'm like, oh shit, I can do sessions. Yeah, yeah. You know, and suddenly I'm playing with him. And then George DeCoulias is calling and saying, hey, come play on this session. Come do this, come do this. So right away, I just was busy enough. And it was a whole new environment. I'd been here, but I'd never lived here. So I was really feeling great. And then, you know, that went on for a couple of years. And then the TV show, we started pitching it in 2003. and got a deal with a production house, and then went to FX, and they were like, we love it, let's do this. And so for like a week, I'm a TV producer.
Right.
And then everybody at FX got fired. So like my A&R guy got fired. So it went back on the back burner. But around that same time, a band called Stereophonics, good friends of mine, a Welsh rock band, their drummer Stuart was flaking out. And he's a dear friend of mine, and I'd been telling him for a year, dude, you're going to fuck this up. Don't do this. Get your shit together. And he didn't. And they called and said, hey, can you come to the Fillmore and play? Yes. And then I did that. And they're like, well, do LA too. Okay, so I played San Francisco and LA. And then they said, well, we're doing Chicago, Toronto, and Boston, and New York, and that's it. Can you do those? I said, yes, I can do those. Okay, fuck it. Can you just do the rest of the tour? Yeah. So then, you know, a sit-in turns into 10 months on the road, mostly in Europe with Stereophonics. And so that was my first time touring, not with the Black Crowes. Suddenly I'm touring with guys I just get along with great. I'm not in the band. So there's no pressure of band pressure. I'm just out with a bunch of really funny dudes, and there's no stakes for me, you know? And then there were some conversations about, do you think you'd want to stay in the band? And then I'm like, well, kind of. I love the band. And I could live in London. I'm an Arsenal fan. I'd be going to see soccer games all the time. And I was seeing a bunch while I was with them anyway. And so I spent a few months really thinking about it. Like, man, could I do this? Could I really be in a band that's based in London? And the answer was, well, shit, yeah. Why not? And I love the songs. Kelly's a fucking great singer, great writer. By the end of that period, they had gone through all this shit. It was obvious that wasn't going to happen. There's no bad blood. It was just they were going to start going into loops, and they wanted to get really young and stay hip. And to their credit, they did just that. Their career exploded after that. During that time, as I was seeing that not developing, I was like, okay. And then my wife and I were having all these conversations about maybe we should just get to Nashville, because that was always the plan, was eventually we're going to get to Nashville and just be done.
Is she from Nashville?
No, she's from Birmingham, and we both had spent a lot of time there with family. We both knew it well. And we also were thinking about, once the kids start school, are we going to stay in LA? You know, we liked living in LA, but we also came here like with an idea of, let's just take a few years there, see if I develop this TV thing, other writing things. Let's just go see what happens. And we had a couple of really good years here, but we were looking ahead going, well, but school's around the corner. Do we want to move? When I moved at 10, it just changed my whole life in a bad way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, a lot of these thoughts about what's best for the kids. And so in the summer of 2004, right when the Stereophonics tour ended, we said, let's just, before we get too stuck in LA, let's just jump. And so let's get there and stay there. So that's what we did. So we've been there, never looked back since 2004. And the similar thing happened when I got to Nashville. Right away, I started working on sessions and getting calls. And I was the new hip drummer in town for a minute, so everybody wanted to work with me. And I always felt like the biggest hack in the room, you know, because like...
That's a good place to be, though.
It's the only place to be. I do have a few things I always say. And one of them is, if I'm the smartest guy in the room, I get the fuck out of the room.
Yeah.
Real fast. And in those sessions, the stories that these guys are telling of 30 years of Nashville sessions. I mean, I would just sit there like, this is great. It's fucking hilarious. It's insane. They can all play circles around everybody I've ever met in my life. And it's all in these little tiny boxes. It's like, how do you make the same song sound fresh that you just played on yesterday? It's a different, you know, it's the same, you know, 1-4-5, 1-4-5, 4-4-5, 5-1-4-5, 4, you know, it's the same shit. But they're somehow making it fresh. It gets killed in the mix, but in the room, it's amazing. You know what I mean? It's like they Nashville that mix to death. But boy, these guys are playing with so much life and vigor. And every day, they're just showing up and doing the same. It was a great education for me in about another way to learn what I'm good at and what I'm not good at. You know, it's a whole new set of circumstances for me. I loved it. Oh, it was fucking great. And I was really busy doing that. And then, you know, a year later, then the Crowes were back together. And then the whole thing in 05, I decided, well, I'm going to go give this another shot.
And when you went back, do you think that you were capable of enjoying it more than in the initial run?
Yeah, for sure.
Because by then, you had a family. You had established the fact that you could go out and play music with other people if you wanted to. So you didn't have to invest all of your energy into these guys.
When I went back to the band, I had to cancel a ton of shit to do. You know, I had to like call people and go, hey, I can't do that gig. I can't do this. I can't do that. I mean, I had within a year, I had really established myself in Nashville as a really busy musician. And I loved that there was no attachments. You know, I was ready for that. Like, oh, I'm making a living as just a drummer, like a drummer for hire. Like, I'm good enough to do that. It doesn't have to be my thing. And of course, every session people go, man, it turned into a Black Crowes song all of a sudden. You know, I'm like, well, kind of how I play, you know. And when I went back to the band, it was awkward at first. They'd already been playing for a month with a different drummer, and then I finally went back. And so it was a little weird, you know, because, you know, for me, it was kind of like, everybody was happy I was back, but they didn't want to be too happy. You know what I mean? There's still egos at play here. And
they didn't want to acknowledge that you were an essential part of the sound of the band.
They couldn't help but acknowledge it, but they weren't thrilled about it. I don't think they minded acknowledging it. They thought that it was going to turn, like they were worried about how I would respond to it. Because people, you expect people to act the way you think. And it's like, and they saw this as the ultimate arrogance, but I was like, guys, I've never doubted my ascent. I know this already.
Yeah.
You saying it doesn't make me feel more important. I already knew what I need, how important I was. It's fine. Cool. I'm glad to be back. Let's go. I mean, that was me in 05. And that year was good. The main thing that I wanted to go back to do is just rewrite the ending. I just wanted to be really good again. And then there was no talk of recording at all. It was all about just play live shows. And let's see if we can really be the band we should have always been. Let's make an honest effort to just do it right like we used to, all on the same page. We're going to vote on everything. We only do things. We all move together, you know. And so I was really ready to go try that again. And it worked for a year and then some. But by the summer of 06, it was totally unraveling again. And by that point, I'd gotten to where looking now, I can see it. I was way better about keeping myself, protecting myself emotionally and all that than I'd been in the 90s. But compared to where I am now, I was right back in it. You know, mm-hmm. Like I wasn't nearly as crazed about it. But I was also like, well, man, come on. Come on, guys. Let's just get this together. And the truth is, it's real easy to say it now, so I'll say it. I should have, by the summer of 06, it was clear I should have just said, okay, we're going right down the same road. I can totally see where this is going, and I'm not going to do it again. And I did it again. I didn't get hurt the second time, but I still, you know, I rode the same, you know, I rode the car into the ditch, but I had plenty of airbags the second time around.
Yeah, but if you feel like you need all that armor and you need all that airbags, then you're denying yourself the vulnerability that's necessary to really connect with people and the thing that really drew you in the first place.
It's entirely true. And, you know, there were often times where I was accused of, you just don't care. And I'd be like, no, I'm willing to care. I don't care about this. You're right.
Right.
I don't care about this. I care about what we could be and I care about what we were. But yeah, you're no shit, I don't care.
Have you ever seen the Metallica movie?
No. I when it came out, I was like, I do not want
to
watch that.
Too close to home?
and now I just, I would, I could absolutely watch it now, but mm-hmm. It's, you know, it would be,
It's like sometimes, you know, most relationships are not supposed to last. You know, they run their course and they can be great and then you move on. But when there's a giant financial incentive to go back to it.
Well, I mean, and the Black Crowes never got within two zeros of where the world Metallica lives in.
Yeah.
But you know, it's funny you say that because the real easy thing to say in hindsight, and I'm not the only one that would say this. Chris would say the same thing. I think he has. In 97, we fired Mark, which was a ludicrous thing to do. Johnny quit in a week. And when Johnny quit, we were on a conference call and he said, hey guys, I'm quitting. And every fiber in my being was going, quit, just go now, go with him, now. And I wasn't ready to, I was terrified. I mean, I was I was physically shaking at the thought of quitting because not that I didn't want to, not that I knew I wouldn't feel relief, but I didn't have any idea of how not to be in the Black Crowes. And I never didn't know that until that moment. And
but you had already not been in it and thrived.
No. Going back to the 97.
Okay, gotcha.
First time in 97.
Yeah.
No. No, that would have been the time for the, like you said, groups are only supposed to be around, you know, relationships aren't built to last. If the Black Crowes had ceased existing in 1997 in the summer, after having made five albums, four of which were released and one was just sitting there, that would have been perfect. Because eventually everybody would have come back around a few years later and gone, okay, everybody would have gone out and gotten their asses kicked and then said, let's figure it out. And maybe we could have made some sense of it. But that was the first real obvious, every neon sign is flashing, stop the band. And we just, me and Chris and Rich and Pete were like, what are we going to do? And within a week it was, here we go. Let's keep going. Let's just power through it. And, you know, props to us for not allowing it to bear, you know, for getting up and doing something. But the way more responsible thing on every level would have been to fucking, I mean, in a perfect world, we all stop. Everybody goes to fucking therapy. Everybody gets sober. And if not sober for life, at least sober for a few weeks to really just go, how do I really feel? Mm-hmm. But we were never, ever, ever going to be able to do that.
Facing yourself is for pussies.
That's exactly what the Black Crowes would have you believe. And that's, you know, it's this kind of stuff. It's funny because I could have never imagined talking about this shit back then. I mean, like you mentioned, Pete said, go buy this book. It's called Codependent No More.
Did you buy it?
Oh, fuck yeah. I read that shit in 2 days, and then I read it again, and I was like, oh my God, there's actual words for this? Like, this isn't just me. This is people feel like this and do this same stupid shit I've been doing. Yeah, it was huge. And it didn't immediately stop, and it didn't fix me, but it just opened up a lot of doors. You know, Don Was gave me a book when we were recording the record Lions, and it's called The Middle Passage, and it was a Jungian philosopher whose name escapes me right now. But it was just all about facing yourself in middle age. It's all that same shit. It's like, it's not a midlife crisis if you actually face it, you know? Like, what are you really going through? And I read that book in 2000, and I was, you know, I said at the time, when I saw Don, after I quit the band at the end of 2001, and I saw him in LA in 2002, and I said, hey, thanks for that book, because that got me out of the band. And he was like, oh no, I wasn't trying to do it. I said, no, dude, trust me. It was I had put all these pieces together, but that really was a big part of it. And I saw Rick Rubin in 2002. I'd been out of the band for a few months. I'm living in LA, and I felt great about it. I really was, but I still, there were certain things that happened that really helped. And one was, I went to Cello or Ocean Way to see somebody, and Rick was next door doing a session, and I went over to see him. And he said, hey, man, I heard you quit the band. I said, yeah. And he goes, how you feeling? I said, I feel good, man. I feel really good. He goes, yeah, okay. I go, what? He goes, come on, how do you feel? And I was like, oh, he really wants to talk to me about this. And we went out in the parking lot, and I told him about this book. I said, well, you know, I've read this book. And he looked at me and goes, I've read that. That's a great book. And the guy, I can't think of the guy's name, but he told me about several of his other books. And it just led to, we had this hour-long talk about all this stuff. And towards the end of the conversation, I was really surprised. We'd never had that long of a conversation before. And it was really fascinating. And at some point, I said, you know, I just fucking this and that. And he goes, well, you were afraid. And I looked at him. I go, I wasn't afraid. And as soon as I said that, I go, oh my God, I was fucking totally afraid. And he goes, yeah, man, everything's about fear. He goes, everything you've just said is that you were afraid for years, and then you finally faced it, and now you're not. But you gotta, and he was just explaining it, and I was like, up until that moment, I could have never said those words. And all of a sudden I go, oh my God, I was totally afraid. Yeah, I mean, that's really what it was. And oh, thanks, dude. Like, it's just like so simple, but it's not simple until it is. And for me to talk about, oh my God, I was this hapless codependent, I could have never said those words even 10 years ago to you, like easily and confidently. I went to a therapist a few years ago, and just booking the appointment
was anxiety inducing?
No, it was anxiety freeing. Oh, like, okay. Oh, I'm finally going to help myself, like for real. Like, right. I had done a lot of my own help.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd gotten to a very, you know, like when the band blew up in 2014, I was like, I was angry about it. I was embarrassed about how it ended, but I wasn't sad about, I mean, the Black Crowes needed to be done. And I have plenty of other shit I'm doing, great. But then there was this residual anger a couple years later that was still there. And I was like, I'm finally ready to talk to somebody. I went to a therapist for a couple of years. And within a month, I was like, holy shit, have I dropped off a lot of bags. Like, and it was more the act of doing it than even what happened. I don't know if it was more, but I was more aware of the fact that just doing this showed me, okay, I got this, man. It's easier to admit I'm a mess than to be a mess.
Mm-hmm.
Admitting it takes away about 90% of the pressure of it.
Yeah, because you put so much energy into masking or trying to hide that you're a mess.
100%. I did that for so long. I was really good at it. Well, it's a really bad thing to be good at for your own psyche.
I'm glad that you're finally actualized.
Namaste. Hey, I'm on my way, baby.
What do you care about the most right now?
Well, I mean, my family is, there's no close second. As far as what I'm doing, you know, Trigger Hippy, my band, we just put our second record out. That scratches every musical itch I have. I love that band. I love that record. And I'm thrilled that we're about to get out and start playing a bunch of shows. I've got this book. You know, it's funny.
Have you heard from anybody in the band since you wrote it?
I haven't heard from either of the brothers. I've heard from other members
mm-hmm.
who have all said the same thing. Thank you. Fucking thank you for this. and that extends to members of our crew for years. I've heard from a ton. I mean, I've heard from people that I haven't talked to in 20 years, you know, who were record label promotion people or people in radio. I mean, people of on every level of the peripheral, you know, of the periphery of the Black Crowes. And it's funny. It's like the book is now, oh, I can tell him this story now. Like everybody's coming to me with, well, you know, this thing happened and it was, and I'm hearing a lot of, you know, like horror stories of the way people were treated. But the word that I'm getting from literally dozens of people is closure. Everyone's going, thank you for giving me this closure I didn't know I needed. Because very few people that gave their time and efforts to the Black Crowes left with a feeling of, oh, that was good. Glad I did that. I don't know if anybody did.
Yeah, and that's compounded when you feel like you're being mistreated, but it's not being acknowledged by anybody else.
Of course, exactly. Yeah. Everybody, like again, the secrets go real deep. And the number of people who have carried around that, it's embarrassing to go, man, I just got fucked by these people I put my life and my heart and soul into.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not talking about band members. I'm talking about people who, you know, at record company people that have 12 bands they're working, they were very passionate about us. And they were, you know, we had people, like you said, you know, we had this great manager, Pete. Man, we had people at every walk of our career lining up to put everything they had on you know, all hands on deck for us.
And that system doesn't even exist anymore.
No, it doesn't even exist anymore at all. And I've heard from, I've had a few conversations with people that were really very difficult to hear. Like, you know, thank you because, you know, the reason you haven't seen me is this, and stories that I didn't hear at the time and I never did. And it's like, you know, it's gut-wrenching to hear that. I'm fine with all the shit I went through, but it's still hard to hear about what other people went through.
Did your kids read the book?
No, they've both started it and flipped through it, but neither one of them's dug into it too much. There's nothing in there they haven't probably heard about. I don't think there's anything that would stun them. Some of the bigger, like, oh my God, this really happened moments, they already know those. It was weird. When I told them that the band was done, I mean, they were crushed. I told my daughter the Black Crowes broke. And it was funny because Chris blew the band up in early 2014, but we didn't really, no one knew for a long time. Again, that's another secret I was not interested in divulging because it didn't reflect on me poorly, but it was just so embarrassing. It's like, why'd the Black Crowes break up? After 27 years, the lead singer demanded all the money. I mean, that's just horrifying. It's like, oh my God, really? So it wasn't like public knowledge. Then once it became public knowledge, I guess it wasn't that long. Anyway, some point, months after I knew that was the end of the band, because once that email came, I was like, I will never, okay.
You're referring to an email from Chris's wife at the time.
So Chris's wife, who was managing him, emailed his new demands to continue in the band. And I mean, read that once and I'm like, I will never be in a room with this person again. There's no mea culpa big enough for that one. I'm sorry. I don't. And you got the out. You can say I was wasted. I was on drugs. No, you weren't. You're nuts. And I'm fucking done.
You're wasted on money.
Yeah. We're trying to be. So I knew that was done. Anyway, all this to say, I mean, I told my daughter, and I mean, you know, you think about what your identity is, and she never walked. My kids don't walk around like, my dad's into Black Crowes, but it's all they know. And I mean, she looked at me like the earth had just fallen out from under her feet. Like, what does this mean? And I was like, oh, it's fine. You know, I have a national radio show. I've got another band. We're fine. It just, it wasn't a question of, oh my God, are we going to be broke? It was, who are we? Like,
wow.
What the fuck? Because, you know, in her whole, you know, everybody, you know, she was 11 or 12. Mm-hmm. And, you know, well, when I was 11 or 12, my dad worked it up. You know, he was the bowling guy. You know, yeah. Everybody's, you're.
No, I remember my dad had a restaurant with his cousin, and then they got into a dispute, and my dad divested, and that was kind of weird because I had grown up working there. And
sure, it's terribly alarming. I mean, and for their friends, you know, who have like quote unquote normal jobs, you know, like they come to a Black Crowes show and with their buddy, and you know, there here's a kid who's like, this is where your dad works, and everyone drinks beer, and it smells like weed. You know, it's like it's a different world. And, you know, all those things, you know, it's like it's not like it's just me. My entire family is very involved. And for that to never, you know, not that that was ever a consideration that anyone else gave a shit about, you know, I certainly did. But
if you could go back in a time machine to 1987 and talk to Steve Gorman, what advice would you give him?
I would say, don't go against your gut. You know when you have enough character and you're smart enough that you should navigate. This is all going to be crazy, and just don't betray yourself, because the only regrets I have are the moments when I let things go that where I went against my better judgment, or where I didn't show, you know, where I allowed my character to be, you know, weakened or distilled down, you know? Like when we made our fourth record, Rich decided he wanted to play bass. Like I'm just going to play all the bass. And for a variety of reasons, I rationalized and convinced myself, well, I can't stop it, so I should just try to make it easier for Johnny. And the right answer was no. Go fuck yourself. I'm gone if you do this. I'm leaving. Even if Johnny stays, this tells me, this goes against everything I believe. And I stayed, and I shouldn't have. You know, like that, shit like that. It's kind of a big deal. But at the time, and then I internalized that, and that just, you know, it's like these shame spirals. It's like, where does it start? That's a pretty good place to start.
It starts with Catholicism.
There is that too, yeah. You know, there's this hybrid of this hybrid monster of mine where I'm doing everything I can to make it better for everyone to keep it working, and I'm betraying myself at the same time. And it's a pretty brutal thing to do to yourself.
Listening to your internal compass can be really hard though, especially.
It was challenged at all times in this band.
Yeah.
But again, I don't, the things that they don't haunt me anymore. The things that haunted me and the things that led to more bad behavior was just that's where it always started. The trouble started, you know, I was fine to stand up. Many times I said, absolutely, I'm just at least going to air this out. I'm not going to convince anyone I'm right, but I have to at least say it so that you know where I stand. I'm fine to go with the team against what I think makes sense, as long as we're all going together. I did that a million times. But it was when I wouldn't even say it. Like when I just said, oh, fuck it, whatever. I mean, those are the things I look back and go, come on, you fucking asshole. You should have stood up.
Steve Gorman, thanks so much for being on the show.
I'm happy to have been here. Thanks for having me.
The Trap Set is produced by me, Joe Wong, along with Chris Karwowski, who also edits the program. Follow us on Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook at The Trap Set, and visit our website, thetrapset.net, to subscribe to our show for free. If you enjoyed what you heard today, please donate to our show. If you can't afford to donate, please tell a friend and give us a good rating on iTunes. Send your feedback and guest requests to thetrapset@gmail.com.